Mark Langfang, how are you? Shalom.
Thank you.
Mrs. Helen Freedman,
Shalom.
And Sara Klasner. And today we're going to be talking about the Holy Land of Israel. Number one, welcome aboard. Welcome. Thank you for coming here. And today we're going to talk about Israel, not just the holiness, but the fact that giving up land and the peace process is actually endangering lives on both sides. And it's counterproductive, and it's really not a peace process. It's exactly the opposite.
Rabbi, if I may.
It's a war process.
I'd like to start out by just stating some basic principles.
Sure.
For us to understand and for your listeners to understand.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Newt Gingrich shocked everybody when he said there is no Palestinian people and there is no legitimate claim to a Palestine inside of Israel. And what he was saying was something that Arab leaders had said in 1945, 46, prior to Israel's creation as a state. And the understanding that this is the truth. And so everything that has been created since the establishment of Israel with this myth of an ancient Palestinian people going back 1,300 years and a legitimate claim to the land of Israel, which created a distorted understanding that settlements and land and all of these are obstacles to peace, this is all a lie.
Well, anyone who wants to clearly see who owns the land of Israel, it's clearly the Jewish people. If you open up a Bible, it talks about it. God clearly defines the borders. He tells us exactly he's gonna lead the Jewish people into Israel, etc. So it's the only land which Abraham actually purchased for to bury his wife Sarah, and Joseph purchased Shechem, and David, King David, purchased Jerusalem.
Yes, but you see, it's just those holy places.
Right. No, but we're talking
that
about
the Arabs are after.
No, right, right.
Because they want to deny our history.
Actually, Mark has an interesting map over here, which shows us that they're after the whole of Israel, and they're after the whole of Israel. And the point that we're trying to bring out is that the trading land for peace doesn't bring peace; it brings the reverse.
Yes, and to follow up what Helen was saying, the important point that Mr. Gingrich was hitting at was it was a tragedy and is a tragedy how they have in fact invented this people. And the question is, who invented this people? It was invented by the entire Muslim Islamic world as a really a battering ram against Israel. And
let's give you
an idea
of let's talk practically.
Practically, this area here is what is commonly known as the West Bank, Judean Samaria.
Judean Samaria.
The reason why it's called the West Bank is simply this is the Jordan River,
and anything west of the bank, it's called the West Bank.
The West Bank could be this whole thing. It's not a bank.
Now with this,
it's in fact a mountain range right here.
So with giving away. We know that they gave back the Gaza.
What happened was they gave back land.
Right.
And in return for land, they got rockets.
Right.
And so right now, what's happening is you're having Katusha rockets, like not this truck exactly, but one pipe at a time.
Right.
Firing these rockets into pre-67 Israel. Into schools. And in fact, a four-year-old boy was killed in his nursery school. A four-year-old Jewish boy. And you should also know the firing of these Katusha rockets into civilian areas is a war crime under the Geneva Convention.
Right.
So, in fact, Israel gave up land.
And they got rockets.
They got not only rockets, they got war crimes committed against them because there are no army people soldiers in Sderot. There's no army people in Ashkelon. Yes, they're reservists, but they're not armed. It's not an army base.
Right.
So firing these Katyusha rockets into civilian areas purely to kill civilians is what is going on in the Gaza Strip right now. And if
God forbid,
a million times over, they got the West Bank, instead of firing from the Gaza Strip, they'd be firing from the West Bank right into this densely inhabited area. And I have to emphasize something. Around the Gaza Strip, you have mostly farmland and empty land. Here, you have 70% of Israel's population and 8% of her industrial base.
From Haifa to Tel Aviv.
From Hedera to Ramla, right, down to here. The key point is, it's like firing a rocket from Brooklyn into Manhattan.
Right.
They would be firing a rocket from Brooklyn into Manhattan, the density of Manhattan, killing people.
So let's talk about this. This is really about...
And so it's really a war process.
A war process.
It's not a peace process.
Okay, which everyone knows that there's been more deaths since they started the Camp David Accords and so on. And let's talk about, you know, back in the Camp David Accords in the late 70s when I was in Israel as a young kid, the Menachem Begin, the late prime minister, actually went and attacked the Iraqi nuclear reactors. And the whole world, if you remember, the cover of Time magazine at that time came out against it.
It's terrible.
And now we're faced with the same problem with Iran.
Yes.
And instead of trying to go in and preempting and cleaning up and doing what you have to, it's like if you wait longer, it end up costing more lives.
Yes.
So
well,
what's the rationale behind?
The problem with Iran, Rabbi, is that apparently this process of acquiring nuclear weapons and building them and so on has been going on for years, and they have been able to bury these installations very deep below the ground,
The point I'm making over here is that if America or Israel doesn't disarm the enemies first, what happens? They have to disarm them in the end, but it ends up costing much more lives and taking a lot more effort to disarm them.
Well, unfortunately, we have Obama as president of the United States, who is unwilling. I mean, he is a Muslim. I think he's interested in advancing the Muslim cause more than he is
protecting
the American cause. And I think that he, for instance, today, he allowed a story to get out saying that the Mossad, the Israeli Mossad, is working with groups within Iran to assassinate these nuclear scientists. Now, it seems it's perfectly all right for America to go and assassinate bin Laden, and it's certainly all right for America to put drones out and to go after targeted objects, but when it comes to Israel, there's only criticism. And I think Israel has to understand that they're on their own.
And also what we have to, Israel has to understand as well as America, we're really about, Israel has to look at the cost of human life. What is the most paramount that has to be protected is human life, regardless of who they are. Let me just finish. So therefore, if it requires a person for us to take out a terrorist or Iran or so on to protect human life, just like you wouldn't let a madman in Times Square run around with a nuclear, with a even machine gun or anything.
The way I frame it is, if this were 1938 or 39, and we knew what a nuclear bomb could do, would we have just sat there and let Hitler get a nuclear bomb? All things being equal. Well, this Iranian regime is as bad, if not worse, than Hitler. In fact, just this past Friday, in a sermon, not President Ahmadinejad, the Supreme Leader Khamenei, in a sermon, said that Israel was a cancerous tumor that has to be cut out. Now, anybody saying Israel is a cancerous tumor that's got to be cut out if they look at what Hitler said, that's okay. Right up there with Hitler.
Okay. Let's talk about, we know what the problem is. Let's talk about the solution. The Rebbe, and Sarah's going to back me up on this, that the Rebbe said that we have to, besides protecting ourselves, arming ourselves, and so on, we also have to be prepared and do things physically, meaning put tanks on the borders and so on. But we also should realize that this is a godly given land, and we should stress the fact that it's godly, and it's really about everyone. And Mashiach comes, the Messiah comes, the entire world will come to recognize. It's amazing that the entire world is focused on a little piece of land, which doesn't have any major resources, doesn't have any major oil fields, but yet the world is focused on this. So why? Because at the end of the day, it represents the connection. It's a local call, like we were saying before. You know, it's a local call. It's a call from Israel. It's a local call. And let's talk about, Sarah, you want to talk about what, just like the women taking a role in Mitzrayim, in the going out of Egypt. Let's talk about maybe some of...
I think this is very present, that yesterday was the birthday of the trees, and the Lubavitcher Rebbe talked specifically about the land of Eretz Yisrael, because he was speaking about the seven species, and he was stressing how important it is not to give a single piece of land. And even in the time when he spoke about it, it was very present and applicable. And even now, even more so today, that we shouldn't give up a single drop of land. And coming from a perspective of a student who was on campus in university, and when you would see different Arabs speaking out about the situation in Israel, and Jews would come and represent themselves and to stand behind Israel, what was lacking was knowledge. What was lacking was understanding. They were there to represent the land, but when it came to debate or when it came to even state their plea, there was nothing to be said.
Which is
a big problem.
Which is what's our main?
I'm saying even right. To be said about the knowledge right. Of what's going on now right. Or what needs to be going mm-hmm. on, or just the back and forth of whose land it is, what's happening, what's the current situation, and what needs to how we need to stand our own ground.
Right. So the first thing is we have to tell the world this is a divinely given gift from God. To act as a trustee. We don't own it. It's in trust for every Jewish person. Whether he lives in Israel or doesn't live in Israel, he has the exact same stake in the land. That's what the Rebbe said, that every single person has a piece of, every single Jew has a piece in the land. Now the land itself is all holy land, but it's also holy for another reason. Of course, it actually represents godliness and goodness. And like it says, the Bet HaMikdash, the temple stood on Mount Moriah, and it stood as a beacon. And during the times of the temple, the entire nations would come offer their pilgrimage and offer their sacrifices and so on to the temple, because it stood as a beacon. Yes. And I think today the challenge is like all challenges, we don't see the beacon physically. And the idea is to realize, and I think if every Jew came from that premise that this is a godly given land, it's not negotiable.
But Rabbi,
it's not negotiable.
The problem, I have to say so, also exists within Israel itself.
Right.
We're getting mixed messages from Israel itself because the leadership in Israel is not speaking the way you're speaking. The leadership is not talking about the biblical entitlement. They're talking about land for peace. They're talking about settlements being obstacles to peace. They're talking about freezing building of settlements. Let me tell you one quick story.
Sure.
My organization, Americans for a Safe Israel, we run trips to Israel twice a year. We bought a Torah scroll in Crown Heights. We wanted to dedicate it to the Fogel family that had been murdered in Itamar. We brought the Torah scroll to Israel from New York. we actually had to build a little synagogue in an outpost called Givat Aryeh, which was also built in memory of the Fogels. And we were going to put that Torah scroll inside the new synagogue. We did it all. We had a fantastic ceremony. 2 weeks later, we're back in New York, and we discovered that the Israeli army was sent into this outpost to destroy the synagogue and destroy the community. The Torah scroll was rescued. It's being saved in Itamar. Now, when these things happen, and this isn't the only place, you know, there's one after another.
Unfortunately,
demolitions. How do people get the message that Sarah was speaking about, that you're speaking about, that Mark is speaking about? How do people get the message that this is holy land?
Not only it's holy,
and that we're entitled to be there.
And not only that, and trading land for peace or giving up land only brings to instability and bloodshed and murder and so on.
That is,
you know, it's even if let's take aside, even if it wasn't holy, even if you went from a purely military perspective, did anything good come out of the Gaza?
The people there, 6.5 years, they're still suffering.
I'm telling you. And did anything good come out of letting go 1,000 prisoners or 800 prisoners?
No.
You know, this is proven time and time again. Even the Arabs themselves don't appreciate, instability.
But Rabbi, what Sarah is saying is a deeper problem. It's a deeper problem that is really representing a failure of American and Israeli Jewish leadership. That the leadership has failed to understand that they need to educate college kids, they need to explain to college kids exactly what the problems are.
And
I don't mind if they explain the left wing perspective, and as long as they explain the whole perspective, then people can understand what they are doing.
Right.
But the problem is that there has been a total failure of the American Jewish establishment to recognize that these college kids, if they aren't taught what's going on in the newspaper, they are going to be totally incapable
of dealing with themselves. Go ahead, Sarah, so what would you say if you had 1 minute, 2 minutes to tell your fellow, what would you tell them?
Well, first of all, I think it has to happen before college.
Right.
That it's not that the second that we come onto college campus and we're faced
with it.
Okay, but what would be the main point? That the land of Israel is a holy land, number one.
Not only that it's a holy land, but even if we go through history of what's happened when giving over land, that it hasn't been a result of peace, and that so we shouldn't continue to, just like we learn history in school, in order not to continue to make the same mistakes.
Right.
It's the same thing with the land of Israel, that there's no giving up land in order to receive
peace.
It hasn't even worked. And that we have to stand our ground and say that this is our land and we're the Jewish people, and without it.
And I think all will agree, both Christians, Muslims, and even non-believers, have a easier time to pray whatever they want to pray in the land of Israel, as opposed to in
absolutely.
We run an organization for the Seven Laws of Noah, which we want Muslims, Christians, and even non-believers, all non-Jews, to keep the Seven Laws of Noah. And one of the things is Judaism doesn't try to make everyone Jewish. On the contrary, it discourages. But the Seven Laws of Noah is for everyone. But the bottom line is that Christians in Israel are better off than Christians in, let's say, Syria.
Or Christians now in the Gaza Strip.
The point is that it's
Israel protects all of the religions.
Right.
Yes, but the Vatican is also interested in coming in and taking over Israel's holy sites.
Right.
And even though Israel bends over backwards to respect everybody else's rights to their holy places, it doesn't happen going in the other direction.
It's getting fabricated.
Right, right. But the idea is that Israel is a holy, godly given land to all to the Jewish people, and it serves as a beacon of light for everyone. Like we just celebrated Rosh Hashanah Le'ilonot.
Light and justice.
Light and justice, exactly. Just as the Torah is there as a light, as a beacon of light of justice to all. It shows a person how to live, a way to live, and by means of living the Torah life, both Jew and non-Jew, he has a fulfilled life and a happy life and a content life, and he's happy with his family, he's happy with his wife, with his kids, with his neighbors, and everyone in the whole world is happy. But the idea is that Torah is eternal, and the Jewish people are eternal, and so is the land of Israel is eternal.
Well, so, we have to hope our Jewish people get this message, Rabbi, because, well, you know, so many of them really don't understand this. And when you speak about the Bible to them, they're sort of embarrassed, you know,
no,
like
even
that old book that, you know, that
doesn't
people
seem,
stopped reading,
right.
You know, and so on. It's just a message that really has to transfer itself to people so that they take it seriously.
But I think ultimately it should just be a message of strength, because ultimately that's what we're lacking. You're saying mm-hmm. Israel's bending over backwards, and it's a matter of being strong in who we are and expressing who we are and standing firm in it.
And believing, I think we have to believe ourselves. And once
Absolutely.
once we believe ourselves, right. Nothing, you know, nothing can stand in our way.
But you can't believe in yourself if you have not had any tools or any facts to give yourself knowledge and be able to defend yourself.
Right. And it's not, God forbid, in an arrogant way.
No one's saying arrogant.
This is a reality. This is a divinely, you know, it's not in an arrogant way. It's anyone's welcome to live in Israel. Anyone's welcome to participate and go visit the holy sites and so on, to daven over there and to come there, but it's reality. God is reality.
Yeah, Rabbi, I think we should define some specific things that people can do to prepare themselves for what's coming.
They can visit your website.
Right. They can visit mine.
They can look at this map on Mark's website.
MarkLangfang.com.
And yep. Understand, you see, this truck that he has here in the Gaza Strip, you know, that's Hamas is there in Gaza now. Hamas is a surrogate of Iran.
Right.
Up there where he has Lebanon and the arrows coming down, that's another surrogate. There are
they're all colonies,
hundreds of thousands of rockets pointing to Israel's north. We have to understand that the reason it's so difficult for Israel to make a decision about going after Iran, one of the reasons is that Hamas and Hezbollah would be activated immediately.
You know what?
And this could be, you know, a very, very serious tragedy for Israel.
Well, just like many thousands of years ago in Iran, there was a wicked Haman, which were coming up to the holiday of Purim, which also tried to destroy and annihilate the entire Jewish people. And just as then, Mordechai stood, gathered, and the Jewish people, and particularly the children, like Sarah was saying, getting the younger generation involved and getting them steadfast in Torah and mitzvahs and knowing who they are, what they are, and what they have to do. Just as then, thousands of years ago in Iran, Mordechai was victorious and Haman hung, so too. If we just do what we have to and keep our ground
educating,
so too the Hamans of our today.
And they're out there.
They're out there. We don't have to mention his name. I don't want to mention his name. But we all know his name, you know. But the point is, the Hamans of today will, particularly from Iran, will have their final fall, and let's hope it happens speedily.
Amen.
You know, because at the end of the day, they're no friend of Jewish people, and they're no friend of any people. They're not even a friend of their own people. They want to kill, and they're not acting for God. They're more on acting for craziness.
Look what they're doing in Syria.
They're not acting for God. So, you know, I think we're gonna have to start wrapping it up. But you know, I want to thank you guys. You want to add some more stories of your...
I just want to thank Sarah. I think she's been a clarion voice.
Okay.
I want to thank you.
We're going to put Sarah to work.
Okay, okay, okay.
For Save Israel.
Okay.
Because we need this kind of young understanding and vision.
And we need the vision to realize that just like thousands of years ago, we have the secret tool. And the secret tool is Torah and mitzvahs. And we stand with Torah and mitzvahs. And Torah clearly tells us, do not give up one inch of land. It's ours. Have a nice day. You're welcome. You know, that's what it is, period.
Very good.
You know, Sarah, thank you. And Helen.
And thank you, Rabbi.
And at the end of the day, the Hamans will keep coming up. But if we, there could be few amongst many, you know, and we'll still win. It has nothing to do with size and so on. Even though we've proven to the world that Israel, through the miracles we've existed, will continue to exist. Be'ezat Hashem.
Amen.
No, thank you for coming, and thank you.
Thank you, Rabbi. Always a pleasure to be with you.
And hopefully we'll see, we'll all go to Eretz Yisrael, to Israel today. Every Jew should go. Thank you very much.
Amen.
Good night. And Am Yisrael Chai.
Am Yisrael Chai.
Am Yisrael Chai. That's it.
All right, time for a little music.
Okay, Am Yisrael Chai. Thank you.
Thank you.
Shalom.
Shalom. Are we done?
Shalom with a blessing.
Okay.
Okay, it's a wrap.
It's a wrap. Okay.
Thank you, Gloria.
Thank you. Okay, leave your mics on the floor.